Yeah.
How many times do you comment? So you have the rubrics, kind of an idea of each topic, how well they did. Do you have comments? How often do you comment?
When I'm grading them for participation specifically, I always give a comment back with the rubric. Always.
Okay.
So it's basically anybody who got graded.
So you use those little bubbles, you have something in there?
No, it's just the one comment box. So with participation, I used to be a grader for the written assignments too, and then I will have comments inside the papers that I'm returning. But with the discussion, it's really all happening in that comment box. And that's just because of, so I say, nice work, thanks for bringing useful outside resources. And I will usually give some sort of attaboy in here too, just in general, like, wow, this has been really great. I love having a new class, So, what I haven't figured out, I was gonna ask you, has anybody figured out how to make the rubric visible except how I did it, which was posted as a document? I have not figured out how to show it to the students yet. Is there a way? Like, I looked and I couldn't find one.
You mean to see this?
Yeah.
The grading part of it?
Well, I meant like outside the grading. Like, I just posted it as a screenshot in a document, but I haven't found another way to do it.
In the assignments, you can do that. When you create
But for discussions, which are assignments, but not...
Well, you can make the discussion into an assignment, right?
And they actually have to be assignments to be graded. That's the thing.
I think so.
Yeah. So they are assignments in that sense, but I couldn't figure out...
It should be at the bottom and connect to or find the rubric the same
even
as you connected it with the discussion. It should be the same. Somebody give me an out of affirmation.
I know what you're talking about with the documents, but I couldn't figure out if that was happening with the discussion form.
I think as long as you create an assignment.
If we go to student view, could we check it?
Settings.
So I think if you create an assignment and then you link the assignment to the discussion, and you say, do this, that, the other thing, and then you link to the discussion, and then you can add a rubric to it.
And they'll see the rubric once it's embedded within that assignment.
I have my other assignments like that, but does that work for discussions too?
If they are assignments.
If they're assignments, they will. All right.
And John, what do you mean by if the discussion is an assignment?
So I think you can just have discussions made and then students know to go there because we have a discussion each week. Or you can make the discussions and say, all right, I'm going to make an assignment, and for the assignment this week, you're going to do X and you're also going to go to a discussion. And the discussion rubric, like you have two assignments. One assignment specifically is to go to participate in a discussion. That's what I think.
So with the document assignments, where I see the rubric is like here, but I'm not seeing it here.
Yeah.
That's what
that is
not.
This is a graded discussion. Does that link you to an assignment, kind of assignment view for this? Is that a link? If you hover over the this is a graded discussion template.
That was just language.
No.
And nothing underneath the.
And you can also have
show
a graded discussion.
Show rubric.
Yeah.
Oh, wait.
Show rubric. It says show rubric.
That's interesting. So you have to ask for it. But is that because it's a discussion form that you have to do that?
Because
I know with the other ones, it just shows up on the same page. That's interesting. Okay.
So I guess
you have to ask for it.
Explain to the students how to do that.
Right. Okay.
Cool. I think a screenshot is a good idea.
That was a great book around. Cool. All right. Well, so. I started taking some notes on the bottom of the page that you have linked to in the Canvas site. How many of you have already used discussions in any learning management system? Okay. How many of you keep your hand up if you've also used them in Canvas and thought that this counts? Thoughts on the difference between the two of them? Is it just a matter of the white space? Do you think that they're better? Do you think that they're worse? What are your thoughts? James?
We basically had to think about discussion in a different way than D2L, because D2L, you've got the forum level, topic level, and then the individual replies. So you kind of have three levels of three that nest in each other, whereas in Canvas, you basically have forum, and then you kind of have topics because there's a space between, you know, like if you reply specifically to somebody else's reply, it kind of links to it in Canvas versus starting a new thread. But this, you know, the only thing that doesn't make a difference really is that little white space. And then D2L, you can also sort easier. And I discovered that the searching feature is also different. In Canvas, if you search, if you go to the topic homepage and you search, it will only search the replies. What you have is the titles of your replies. It won't search the full body of all of the...
No, it says search title, body, or author.
Yeah, well, it doesn't search the body, I discovered.
Interesting.
So once you click into and you search now, now it will find all the body. But at that top level, it will only search, it will only do a superficial search.
So we just saw something about binder clips in there. So if I type binder.
Yeah, that thing shows up on.
Yeah. Well, that's kind of.
Yeah.
Kind of a problem. We don't have a lot of discussions. Can somebody go in and create a discussion here? And then let's try it.
I have a question too, Catherine. It looked like in SpeedGrader it shows you everything that student has written for a particular discussion thread.
Yeah.
But it doesn't show the intervening response.
So there's a link which is like a really tiny font, and it says view in discussion. So if you want to see the thing in context, then just click that link and it brings you there. I don't grade for stuff where I have to see that. Like, I'm reading everything anyway outside SpeedGrader, but that's what they do to let you into the discussion.
Because I can imagine a context where a student who's not very good at summarizing what a person said or adding full context would appear to have really short responses, maybe compared to a student who is better at summarizing or clarifying what it is that they're responding to.
Yeah, and I don't grade for length, so I'm not caring about that, but I do grade for comprehensiveness. And that's where I noticed that first post of the week really, really made good now, because people see that I'm comprehensiveness. So even the short ones tend to check that box.
So what, I'm looking for rubrics here, ways to attach the rubrics.
You have to make the assignment, and now go to settings. Settings, right? Right?
Yeah, and it also has to be set graded. Yeah, there we go. You don't tell it to be graded anymore.
So it's a two-step thing. I can't do it directly within that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And now, so you want
to go to the right, top, find
the rubric.
Yep.
Oh, none of these are appropriate, so let's just make it this one. I'd be interested in finding that discussion rubric or that participation rubric, Catherine. So if you share it with me, I'll share it with the rest of the class.
Yeah,
make an attachment and a discussion.
I'm just looking for it now.
You just search for the what she had or tag on it?
Yeah, Kevin Thompson.
Kevin Thompson. Student logging, a connected stance applied. Kelvin Thompson rubric.
All right. You found it?
Yep.
All right. Can you throw it on the activity sheet page on the bottom?
Sure. Put it in my discussion.
Turn it into a rubric and add it to our discussion here. All right, you guys should all be able to access the discussion, right? Open it up, start talking. Let's go. If you're looking for things to write down, write down two things you like about discussions, learning management system discussions, and two things that are frustrating about learning management discussions, and then some things about, I don't know, Canvas specifically, I guess, since we're talking about that.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think through the other big differences. between D2O and campus.
I know I had a whole list, but that was the summer.
So it's gone. When the leaves fell, it fell.
Exactly. Probably before then, but.
So it's things you like in Canvas, or things you like about discussions?
About discussions in any learning management system.
Us students.
So maybe there are some things that you like about discussions in other ones that we haven't figured out how to do in Canvas, but maybe we can.
Well, I always do, so it's in that, I should have read it for the beginning, it's like in my class, it's in the, what I call course mechanics folder, it's like the syllabus, it's
right.
The things, as opposed
the
to
students,
assignments.
The students don't even know that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I think I've had to point people to it a couple times, but. Oh, I point to it from the syllabus page, which I use as the home page. So
oh.
Here's the rubric. Yeah. And I swear this, I don't have any data on this, but I swear they talk more on campus because there's more white space and there's more Facebook. I just have this strong anecdotal sense that I've seen more talk.
What I knew, because I taught the same class in each of both, and then in campus this summer, and the discussion was much better in campus. But we can also change the number of other course dynamics that we do that.
Yeah.
That could have
it's
been.
So hard to tease them.
It does seem that by and large Canvas might be more student friendly, but it's less instructive as far as discussion.
Yeah.
So I mean, I guess it's a good thing it's more student friendly, but yeah, it's a little bit more difficult to work with.
I've seen
this
wrong. I've seen there's wonder when they ask instructors. What's the number? Like, can you make a testing of anything?
Yeah, not really.
So, do people find in discussions that, or do you ask that they use images or include any specific media, James?
I was going to say, I have never really done that, but the ease with which in Canvas students can bring in images would make me more likely to be like, hey, how can I make this more image-based kind of discussion?
It still requires them to have the file on their laptop and, or whatever and upload it from there, right? It's not as easy as copy and paste like in Google Docs or Microsoft.
You actually have to upload it through files. You can't upload it from somewhere else.
You can upload it, I think, from...
I just did the URL.
From
the URLs work, but...
Okay. But you can't take a screenshot, for example,
yeah.
And say, paste it in.
Right.
for class discussions that I had, and I often use WordPress, I would have things like use an image, use three bullets, use a paragraph, so that they get a chance of expressing what I want them to do in three different ways of thinking about it.
So how did you embed that? You did have to upload it as a file, or are you saying you don't?
I did that one just with URLs, so when I posted, and then the image box right there.
Oh, sorry.
No, that's okay.
Let me go back. And then you did this, yep. That image.
And I just did URL. Mm-hmm. So if you go in the Canvas, is that one of the files? Is that what you were talking about, Catherine? Files?
It has to be uploaded already.
Okay,
see,
sure.
Whereas
sure.
D2L would let you upload something at this
direct.
Point, so mm-hmm. it was like way easier. Mm-hmm. But you know, once you learn it, you learn it.
Sure. Yeah. Good point.
There.
How did you do that? I didn't watch. I'm sorry.
That's all right.
I was trying something else.
I just went to files at this point.
Oh.
So
okay.
Canvas, and then I checked in the files here. The only files, well, no, we have conversation attachments, so I bet we can find
a link. Oh, but you can do it via link,
there.
Too.
No.
Okay.
This is why I don't want to be
there's a picture of the Mona Lisa for you.
I know. Yeah, it's on.
Or from Flickr.
Yeah.
But what I really want to do is be able to, like, take a picture and just paste it. Paste. But I can't.
Why isn't it Instagram?
Or any number of them.
Yeah.
But yeah, files and links, I think, are good.
Oh, what's this? Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you noticed, James, but when I made the discussion assignment here, the only person that this is assigned to is you.
I feel singled out.
So I'm doing all this work for no credit, is that what you're saying?
Yeah. And James isn't doing anything, and he's the one that's going to get graded on this. Here, Jen, I'll add you. Oh, because you're a teacher, and James, you must still be a student.
Oh, maybe that's it.
I don't know.
Oh.
Yeah, these people are still students, because they were here 2 weeks ago. So.
Can we talk about the podcast feed setting and what that's about?
Yes. Karen?
Well, I added a link to the how-to on the Canvas site. It is on the activity sheet. Oh yeah, right there in the very second section on Medium, create a discussion. Keep going. A little higher. Second section, right there, yeah. See that right in the middle under 2A?
Hey, yeah.
So that'll tell you how to do it there.
And why would we do that? What does that do?
Well, I think you could use it for a variety of different things. In a discussion, perhaps it could be a starting off point, right, to prompt a discussion, yourself or someone else who does a podcast, listen to this and then discuss your thoughts regarding X, Y, or Z, or create your own questions. I don't know, I think it could be used in a variety of ways.
So it'd be the same thing as starting a discussion with, like, watch this TED
talk
and reply to that, or give your thoughts on that. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Excellent. Do a prompt.
But it doesn't do the I don't even know what the words are. When you're watching a video like on Facebook, right, and it does the timing of when the comments came up, right? And it sort of scrolls with you so you can it's just a regular discussion, but you can start with a podcast.
Yeah, right. There are tools that let you There are tools in YouTube that let you do that, where comments will appear as, and you can add comments to specific parts of that. And I think we talked about that in a video, active teaching lab. And that's kind of a neat way to kind of go back and have a discussion in the video itself, much more tied to the video, which can kind of be neat. And certainly in video, in YouTube at least, if you put the time signature of like O:31 or whatever, then that'll show up as a link in your comment. So you can have actual whole discussions there.
Right.
What you're talking, what your comment is about the 30-second segment.
I'm just always interested in the way, you know, and I'd be curious to hear you talk more about it too, because you've had successful discussions about how it, on these learning management systems, the conversations, they sort of miss that liveness, right? And the quickness, and they sometimes just become, and I think I wrote this, I found this other thing, look at what I found, right? And whereas the liveness sort of encourages that kind of like questioning, or like if I'm watching, you know, a YouTube video and then you see somebody at 1:10 made this comment, you're like, I totally disagree with that, right? You can.
Yeah, I sometimes think the whole asynchronous versus synchronous thing is like the biggest dividing line there is between certain, I mean, my problem is in our graduate, we have a fully graduate, fully online graduate program. Mm-hmm. We couldn't run a synchronous program. Nobody would enroll.
So this class is online that you're talking about?
Oh yeah, yeah, these are, but I have very seldom tried synchronous simply because the student body doesn't want it. You know, these are quite often working adults who have odd, disparate, I can't even get a chat room together with more than 25% of the class at the time. So I think what you learn to do is, I totally agree with you, like when it's not on the spot, you do get different responses, but you can craft your discussion activities to get rich responses anyway. They're just not in real time.
There is a lot to be said about a synchronous discussion, and Martin Gernsbach is going to come talk about that on April 14th. If any of you were at the Teaching Academy's winter retreat where we had a discussion on controversial topics, that the kind of structure that you can have in a synchronous discussion is pretty good, because you can control the time and be like, okay, next do this, now do this. And I don't know how to do that in an asynchronous discussion yet, but maybe there's a way. If you have any ideas, please share them on our activity sheet.
I'd only ask, and then I'll shut up about it, is that the way that, that my students consume media and the way I consume media is often sort of double screened, right? So, like if I'm watching, I don't know, I think a great example is like a presidential debate or something. Like, I'm not just watching it, right? I'm watching it and I'm like, you know, tweeting it and like following somebody's live feed, or even the way that they, you know, you watch a video on YouTube or Facebook Live and you can engage with it that way. And so when I tell them to go home and watch something, I just find that their experience isn't, like they could watch it at any time and to be able to have that discussion and see, does that make sense?
Well, there's something about the activity of other things happening. So even in Facebook, I can have an asynchronous discussion that feels very live, mm-hmm. because someone else might be typing a comment and it'll say someone is typing a comment and there's like this little activity that's happening there. Mm-hmm. Then I'm like, ooh, I wonder if they're responding to my comment or if they're responding to somebody else's comment.
Well, even if you're watching like a video that was live, it's no longer live, mm-hmm. right? So you're watching it whenever, but you can see, you know, at 1:10, these comments
right.
come up at 1:30, so there's something about
yeah.
engaging that way. And that's something that's why assigning them to watch things sometimes doesn't have the kind of impact I'd like it to, because
mm-hmm.
there's no way to do that is using what would be appropriate.
Well,
I don't have a solution, I just said something that...
You have a solution, you said.
What?
You said you do have a solution?
Well, no, I mean, you can put it on YouTube or something.
Yeah,
but
that would be, and
but
there's another
like
tool that uses
works,
YouTube
so.
That lets you do that, but I can't think of it right now. But yeah, that liveliness of discussions. I generally hate online LMS discussions. I want to like them, I try, and I'll get in there and I'll be like, oh, I'm gonna comment on everybody's and give thoughtful responses and da 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 da. And then I'll be like, I'll check back tomorrow. But things happen in life, and I, tomorrow's like, oh, and I forget about it, and then I come back and I'm like, oh, 7 people responded to my thoughtful comment with even more thoughtful comments, and I totally missed all of them because I forgot about it. So the idea of subscribing to discussions is really important, I think, that you can have your students do.
I was wondering what, so people seem to have done and doing a lot of discussions or have done discussions. I was wondering, you know, what is the best experience you've had doing a discussion with students? And what do you think it is that made it successful? Like just one thing that you thought, wow, I remember this one time, even just one instance within a course, this worked really well.
Synchronous or asynchronous?
Asynchronous. And how, what do you think, if you have any suggestions on or any ideas of why it was, but really I'd just like to hear what your best experience. It would be interesting to see anyone's, what their best experiences on online.
Karen has one.
I have one, yeah. So it was actually really simple and straightforward. Obviously there was a week where there were readings, every week has readings. So chapter reading, so you get concepts, hard, bold lettered, you know, concepts from the book. And then there were a couple of other supplemental readings that addressed those major concepts. And the discussion prompt was simply synthesize the 2 supplemental readings with the concepts from the chapter this week. And it was incredible. The discussions were amazing. Everybody had different perspectives because it was so broad. But it told them, I wanted them to synthesize, bring things together, find connections. And it was an amazing discussion.
Were they supposed to do it together, or are they supposed to do it individually?
Each individual posted, and then the commentary after was incredibly deep because people had seen so many different things and drawn parallels in different ways. It was an amazing discussion, mm-hmm. and I've used it ever since. And I even had a student specifically say, this discussion was the best I've ever had.
Whoa.
So,
was it just 1 week you did that, or is it multiple weeks? Or
I just did that once the first time, and then realized that kind of synthesized approach was a good strategy. So I've also had students like find an article, you know, current event or pop culture that relates to our chapter and explain. So giving students that kind of and not necessarily autonomy, what's the word I want to use? Agency, to connect the course material, which of course then forces them to read the material as well, right? Which is a good indirect kind of strategy. But then they got to dive into something that they themselves found more interesting. And those have been my best examples.
I think that's the big one for me, is the connect the course materials to your own prior experiences. So it's one thing to say, you know, what are your thoughts about this, but it's another thing to say, share a story in your, from your life or from your whatever, your career path or your education path that connects the course readings this week that we talked about, or this idea, this course concept that we just talked about, to something in your life. You know, use pseudonyms if you need to. James.
But also say giving the rules of the road, I noticed a distinct difference of being able to, when being very specific about directing students. So I taught the same class online 4 times. The first 3 times were all pretty similar than the third. Fourth time was in Canvas. And I specifically adopted language around when you reply, the reply needs to include these things, et cetera, et cetera, and it made a huge difference in the quality of the discussion as opposed to just posing a question and being like, hey, what do you think about this?
Interesting. It seems like a balance between having kind of those strict parameters and suggestions and then that open-endedness that
mm-hmm.
you suggested,
yeah.
Karen.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, having...
And that's what I think is, like, when you... Because otherwise you get a lot of the plus ones, or
yeah,
right.
I really like this comment. So to say, hey, you know, you need to explain why you like this comment, or it needs to be, you know, a compliment or a question or something else. So you're giving them some guidance, but you're not like forcing them to. You're allowing them to still be open ended. But otherwise, I think what happens is students kind of freeze, right? Because
mm-hmm.
they're like,
right.
I don't know what to say. I like the comment, you know.
I have a colleague who does something similar where he has, he actually grades, calls it an assignment that students at the end of the course have to present their best discussion posts and say why they were the best. So what he has found is that it means people are kind of thinking about the quality of the post from the beginning because they're thinking, I forget if it's 3 or 5, but they're thinking, I will have to present 5 good things at the end, mm-hmm. and my summary of them is itself going to be graded. So they're a little more conscious of what they're saying. That's what he's found their way.
I like that a lot.
I think my most productive discussions as a grad student were in a course that had 6 people total. And I found that, for me at least, if there are larger groups, even like 10 or 15, it's really easy to get overloaded with just the sheer amount of text to kind of dig through. So having a smaller cohort like that allowed us to really dig into each other's posts and sort of carry through those lines of thoughts in a more meaningful way than just sort of trying to respond to, you know, a bunch of people on a fairly shallow level. So I guess breaking, if possible, breaking classes into smaller units.
This raises a question for me, particularly with online discussions. How then do you incorporate class-wide and group-based? Can you? Do you have to make a choice that the groups are just going to talk to each other and people across class just aren't going to really have a choice to connect? Or is there some way to have those? Because I completely agree that if you have the smaller, they tend to be better, but at the same time, you're like, well, what if this person in group 1, I really want them to talk to this person in group 5.
Right.
And so, you know, is there a way to have a class-wide discussion without taking away from the group discussions or vice versa?
I think that having a sort of a, so you know how we do table discussions? Where we say, all right, what does table 1 think of? So then 2 weeks, 3 weeks, whatever, John Zabrona's going to talk about asynchronous discussions, and he uses the small groups. So he has these small group discussions where there are 5 people in a group, and it is their job to have those discussions. And they're the same students, I believe, all semester. So they really get a chance to know them and go deeply as you would in a small 6-person seminar, right? But what we do in face-to-face classrooms is we say, all right, work at your table and have this conversation, and then report out. So what do you have to report back? And you could have a discussion section with the 5 groups of 5 and then bring them back and say, okay, group 1, what was your big idea? Share with the other groups and then bring them all back into that. And that way that larger discussion will be a little bit more focused around these 5 topics or the 5 big ideas, but that sort of could give some structure to it that, as you say, it's that tabula rasa, right? That blank canvas. What do I do with this? Where do I even start? I'm thinking of, it was a poetry master's classes that I would have, and the free verse is always like, oh, I could talk about anything, and so I talk about all kinds of crap, you know, that just goes on wherever. But if I have to do a sestina, whoa, that's really very, very structured. And in order to do that, like, I didn't have to have a topic in mind. If you give me a form, the form sort of focuses me on, I just need to find something that fills the form. Then I have to, it's like a problem to solve rather than a blank topic. It really helps to structure that, I think, in the same way.
Yeah.